If you, like me, see chaos all around and darkness there which deepens as you look, if faith has turned away from hope and settled into resignation, look up. Look out a while from where you are and think of this. There is time and place to start again. Here we can find the truth God places in our hearts and follow it. A future to be struggled for, to be shaped and strengthened by some of us, for all of us.
Since my first trip here a year and a half ago, I felt a great love for this place and really felt that it was the youth that had to really undertake the development of this place. It wasn't going to be the elders. The intent was to provide an opportunity for Subud members from around the world, mostly youth, to actually get to know Kalimantan and get to know this land here and really get to know each other.
Can we put Giles in charge of organising a survey team? Hamid in charge of organising an anti-termiting team?
Determining.
Henry will sort out the memorial.
Yeah, I'll set. Who wants to do cross bracing?
We can just do that right now.
Have you got anyone to collect the earthquake samples, or do you want someone else?
Do you
want
to do that?
Yeah, I'm happy to do that.
Okay. So Mark is in charge of organising people to go and collect the earthquake samples.
How many people are
we need? 40 kilos of sand from each person.
So we've already got half of
every month.
We've already got half
of every month. We've got lots of choice for
a lot of people really were keen to come to Kalimantan for a camp, a youth camp. And there are yearly camps set up by SYA International, and this seemed to be a good venue.
Because I wanted to come here. I was on my year off. I really felt that Kalimantan held something for me.
So here's your sawo tree, looking a bit more healthy.
Sawo, how do you spell it?
Sawo, S-A-W-O.
Check it out, but I think she would have once been about 150 feet high, maybe 200.
I needed to go on a trip, an environmental education trip, and this fulfills the credit. So now after this, I can graduate.
Myself, I've been battling with this feeling that I would be in Kalimantan, that I had to go to Kalimantan. There was a large part of me labelled Kalimantan, and I was just thinking, how awful, I don't want to go to central Kalimantan.
I mean, we hope to attract not just, holidayers and fun lovers, but people that also had an interest in Kalimantan. And to really expand that interest, I really felt that if people came here, had that opportunity to come here, they would feel that same love that I felt, and that they would, really follow it up.
They're kind of
they are yellowish
golden,
too,
yellowy green.
Yes, and they don't look too healthy. If these were really given manure and looked after, it would do very well. We'd have to clear all the surrounding growth as well and give the tree a lot of air.
There's the shade as well, it's being shaded out. Yes. It's just competition for everything. In a way, my training has been really to bring things together. And that's what I've been doing, is bringing people together, and bringing ideas together, and just combining things. It's agroforestry.
What's agroforestry?
Agroforestry is a combination, it's solving land use problems using a holistic viewpoint. So you consider how all the different components of a land use system interact.
How do the people fit into that?
The people are part of, they are a component of the system.
Yeah. Well, I expect it's birds, more likely to be birds, because they're very small.
I've been drawing pictures of botanical specimens, I've been doing a bit of surveying, and I've also been doing stuff that's complementary to what Somali's been doing. I've concentrated more on details. He's been very much further afield, and he's got things done on larger scale.
So what we've got here is a really deep deposit of alluvial silt, which, well,
is this fertile?
It's extremely fertile. It's very rich, very good for seedlings, very good for vegetable crops. And we've basically got a basin here, which is a flood basin. And because it's quite quiet, the silt settles out very well. And it extends all the way into that sort of mangrove area down there. And having looked at the land capability around, we think that this area around the guest house is probably the most fertile. I want to go for a bit of a walk in there and see the extent of this silt basin.
So what we've got here is sort of low mangrove vegetation. Lots of pandanus. It's really quite beautiful.
Well, I've been studying environmental science and working fairly closely with planners. Yeah, my interests are quite broad, but they're basically to do with the environment and development and sustainable systems.
Okay, so we're going northwest. Chuck a left up there and then we'll go through the burnt patch and come back to the guest house.
That's not blood, by the way, David. That's that red stuff.
That's disgusting. Look at that. He's filming it. Macro.
Ow, that looks sore.
Well, really, I mean, my interest is not... It's not the medical side. It's Kalimantan.
What did she say?
Well, this is a young ironwood tree. It's called ulin.
Ulin.
Which we're going to plant. This is the fruit with the seed in it. All right. She's got also some roots of the ulin tree. That's akar ulin, which is used for medicinal purposes, particularly for backaches. What else is it?
Pinggang.
What is pinggang?
Hip
problems. It also confers a sense of strength. Ask her maybe if we can come and visit her. Mm-hmm. And we'd like to.
Kapan-kapan kita mau ke rumah ibu, bisa?
Bisa.
How are we going to find her?
Ibu siapa namanya?
Ano, Ibu Imis.
Ibu?
Ibu Imis.
Imis. Ibu Imis.
Ibu Imis.
Situ.
Yeah, we can ask. Anyway, we can ask Ibu Imis. Everybody knows.
Ibu Imis.
Ibu Imis. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay. Terima kasih, Bu.
Ya, sama.
Bits of information, bits on the environment, bits on Kalimantan, bits on
forestry,
everything.
Bits on forestry.
A lot.
There's all kinds of interesting things about what's been happening so far in Kalimantan.
Or hasn't been happening
and
so far.
And what hasn't been happening.
Just all the ideas that have ever been in the projects and the research papers.
Kalimantan project, well, it seems to be up until now kind of like a joke.
The land here in Segahong, just off Segahong village in Tenggiling, this totals 623 hectares. And to date, we have a letter from the governor of Central Kalimantan to say that Subud has this concession. It was given in 1981 to Bapak on the basis that we would be able to develop it.
Drive down here, but now it's already growing. As you can see, the scrub growing again.
Our older brothers and sisters started to survey and made an extensive plan to build a township here. However, ensuing projects in other fields, i.e. Esrijoyo and Nugraha, actually took up most of Subud's funds, and consequently the project here in Kalimantan really didn't move forward.
So the dam was planned only in 1990, a couple of years ago, and the guest house was already here. Alasan untuk dam apa?
Untuk membangkitkan listrik.
Okay, so they were planning this dam in order to create electricity.
Satu itu, kedua kalinya untuk danau.
I felt a real enthusiasm from him, and he was really eager that we were here. And he told me about everything that had been planned in the past, and still a real hope that that was going to happen. You know, he drew maps in the sand, and he showed me where they had planned to build the tourist park, where they had planned to build the dam and the 550 houses, and where they were going to have an interfaith area of mosques and churches and the rest of it.
The mail which the holding body of the land receives now show that people are very skeptical about Kalimantan. A lot of people wanting to sell their plots.
Ya saya ya namanya enggak tahu taunya kerja untuk makan ya sudah. Yuk bagaimana saja kemauannya.
Yeah, he'll just follow whatever we want him to do. He says he needs to survive day to day, and he's willing to work, but he's not going to tell us what we should or shouldn't do. They're his dreams too, you know. They're his own personal dreams as well. He feels like a lot of energy and money and time has been spent on those already. And his last comment as we were walking home, he said, if you give up now, you'll have wasted so much.
There have been several pioneers that have come out here. Hanafi was one of those pioneers. He unfortunately died some 2 years ago, leaving this half-finished house. We also have down there the guest house, which was funded by the Kalimantan support group and was intended to create a place where two members could come to stay here and actually try and work out where to go from here.
And the surveyor came, and the surveyor said, we're gonna. And the people of the village said, yeah. And the anthropologist and the oil company came, and they said, we're gonna. And the people of the village said, yeah. And the nutritionist and the missionary and the hydrologist and the World Bank and the film company and the bacteriologist came and they said, we're gonna. And the people of the village said, yeah, yeah. And the grandfathers and grandmothers and husbands and wives and sons and daughters and babies came. And the people of the village welcomes them.
To me, I should learn many things about the community because I have no experience, I have no knowledge of land and forest and etc. I just want to learn about the people we want to live with.
I'm really glad to be here, like in in this village because I'm looking at it from the anthropological perspective, and it's classic. I mean, it's any anthropologist's dream to be here because you can just hang out with the people and really talk to them about how they're living and what they want out of life and how they perceive things.
I never thought that today I'd be heading off to the school to teach English. So one gets a variety of unexpected jobs in this camp.
I expected to come to a wall of jungle with a guest house sitting in the middle of it, you know? It's more civilized than I thought.
Three cokes?
In Seikohong, there are about 500 people, and there are five religions that the villagers believe in. In my opinion, it could be someone's claim himself as Christian, but in daily life, they are regular by culture system. And I think the Hindu Kaharian is a social system of the villager. So I spend much of my time to learn about Hindu Kaharingan and how they believe the connection between nature and the people.
Abi itu ya, giling pinang ya ini, ya balap ngerambang giling pinang, imbalat rokon terahan.
Iyo labi itim kapala na ata jetuhawi ka dandang atingang ije akulu ka dandang isila nyuwang sangku atama aku raja inyara halinum akan raning hataya hatala anang kili kajata amani ngera. Iyo habitin sangkula bula dua niya akan aku tambah kerajaannya arah halingu makan arangi utala isilah nyuang behat pare menyangin tinggang tunga arambang giling pinang mahu bala terukun luta arahan yang luing dandang pinggang ije aloka idana. Jenera sabulau hama aruan dua nong hije kabangku
tayan
nyara habiti makan arani luha atala ilangi.
And just the feeling of being here and the feeling of being with people, it's not money that makes things run and makes things work. I mean, they work for money, they work for their living, but there's a lot of human compassion and human feeling in it. And they're very sensitive and very direct and very honest and very open, you know? And they're very eager to know more about our way of life too, because I was talking to the priest, and he's like, oh, come into my house and hang out and talk and you know, marry one of my sons.
What's that? What you said about the coffee?
Yes, they said that they serve it so hot so that we drink it really slowly, and so we stay longer. So we're forced to stay longer, and it works.
Yep. Last night was really interesting. We went down to the village, and we were invited by the village women to sit and just discuss a little bit about their concerns, about our way of life, about their way of life. And we talked about how in the West we had gone through a process of really turning towards chemicals and science for the answers, and how we're now turning away from this towards more natural forms, and that now people of the West were really interested in traditional herbal cures for things, and that there's a real interest in the jamus. Jamus are herbal mixtures which they make themselves.
This is something that old people do, is do the herbal remedies when they can't work anymore, so they take up selling remedies.
Well, her writing is a lot like a doctor's writing, actually. Can't read a word.
darah tinggi.
That's high blood pressure. Oh, yeah. Obat for high blood pressure. Apa itu bahannya mana itu?
Dari hutan jauh.
Oh. Comes from a tree deep in the forest. This is for people who are paralyzed.
Obat.
Penyakit lumpuh. If you've got paralysis of some kind.
Yang tidak bisa berjalan itu.
For people who can't walk.
I have seen results of jamu working, and it's very impressive. Certainly not in acute problems, but generally in chronic problems, they tend to be very very effective.
Tabas pari.
Tabas pari.
Pari.
Untuk obat luka dalam.
Luka dalam.
Yeah.
For internal
orang yang anu itu
pains.
Karena dysentery.
Oh, dysentery.
Ya ini obatnya.
Actually, we don't know much about it at all. When to prescribe it, how to prescribe it. All these things need to be clarified. And I would use it personally, but I don't think I would prescribe it. I certainly feel that there is a place for it.
Penyakit disentri itu berak tu, darah.
Diarrhea.
They were very intrigued by this because, of course, they feel that this science comes from the West, and they are on a track of modernization, of development, and this is progress for them. And to hear that we're moving away from that, going back to something that they're trying to leave behind, was really unusual for them.
Yeah, I'm quite surprised by the diversity. There's a lot of different sort of vegetation here. There's a lot of potential, and there's a lot of potential for disaster at the same time.
I think it's very interesting for most people to find themselves in an area of the world which they'd always thought of as being rainforest, and actually finding themselves in an area which is actually depleted rainforest.
It's hard for me, at least, to walk through a place like that and not be affected by it.
I expected a lot more forest.
Do you know why it's dry?
Oh, slash and burn.
There's a lot of slash and burns. Locals don't know what they're doing to it, you know? They're doing what they've been doing for thousands of years.
Over here, there's a plantation of cassava, which the villagers have probably put in. Cassava being their main staple crop. Of course, they use a Sweden burning technique, so they just burn the area. It's being cleared before by loggers and then successively burnt so that now it's turning into a grassland, or for the most part actually bracken fields of bracken, which are very unproductive. All of the regrowth, which is probably, you know, 5 or 6 years old between fires, is being killed by each excessive fire, so that eventually it all just dies away, dries out. It's interesting to see how deep it burns. It doesn't really have to be a very hot fire, just enough to kill the outside living cambium, and then the tree's dead.
This has been scrubland for a very long time. For a long time, the people of Tenkiling and this area have taken the wood from this land, and also burnt it so that they can take the rocks. When they burn it, the rocks crack and they can use it to build with.
This is really the problem with the property, as far as I can tell. As you can see, the fire's gone through here. It's turned the wood to ash. It's left a bit of charcoal on the soil, a little surface ash, but every year as that rains, that actually washes into the soil, goes quite deep into the sand, or washes down into the creek and gets taken away. And what you're left with is just sand, really, with very little organic stuff in it at all. The nutrient balance is very rapidly disappearing. That's what it's all about, getting a bit of cassava in for a couple of years, then burning a bit more somewhere else and doing it again. It's not exactly what you call intensive agriculture. So in terms of best use, it's really pitiful.
Yeah, I mean, it is a problem. Well, I think they know that it is the Subud land. I think we have a responsibility to fence it off. I think with this we also have an ability to set a good example. The land which has been cut down, actually, I think in the long term would have been cut down anyway by Subud to carry out farming projects.
Come back to the point about the silt. This area has already been cleared for us by the fire, and it's not exactly too steep. It'd make a great place actually to top dress with the silt from that basin that we were talking about before. And with a little bit of dressing on the surface and utilising the biomass that's here as a composting mulch and actually digging it in, we could have a really quite a productive field here too. I don't see why not.
We were going up to watch volleyball one day, and I saw two eagles, actually two falcons. They saw that I had an interest in the wildlife around there, so, oh, we have a monkey, you know. You want to go see it? We came to this house, and it was in a tiny little box, about that big. Really dark, and all I had was this, you know, piece of plastic blanket in there. Looked really tired, sick. Its eyes were black, its teeth were black. It was really sad. And then we came back here. And we told Henry about it, and then Henry, you know, took it from there, actually.
There's a camera. What's your name?
Sue.
Sue. Sue. Step back. Hello, Sue.
The latest news on the orangutan is that I spoke to the guy who owns the orangutan last night, and he feels quite happy to surrender the orangutan to us. So I'm just going to go over in a little while to see whether we can obtain possession of the orangutan, try and take it down to Palanka Raya, try and get a permit from the Department of Kehutanan, which is the forestry department in Palanka Raya, and see if we can get permission to take this orangutan down as quick as possible.
So it seems that some of the problems of the world are happening in our own backyard. Another reminder that we in Subud are very much part of the world around us. Do we have responsibilities here as Subud members? What are our values? And who in fact are we? Or who do we think we are? Once each of us finds a personal answer to these questions, then we face the most challenging test of all. How do we organize ourselves?
So that's the situation. If anyone feels that they don't have something to do this morning, and I mean do something, that doesn't mean sort of do your laundry or anything like that, I mean something constructive towards camp, then please put your hand up and we'll see if we can find something for you.
Thank you.
didn't come here to make a soccer field. And I didn't come here to make a vegetable patch. I didn't really come here for anything in particular, just for the experience.
Everybody's together all the time.
Ah! What's he doing?
I'm having a hard time just getting into it. How do I think the group's getting along?
Can I be totally honest? People of all different ages, people of all different temperaments, character.
Well, so much has happened. Where do I start?
It's like you almost don't have any time for yourself, and it's almost like you're always being faced with people and what their impressions of you are.
I'm just trying to think of the easiest way to create the joinery. I mean, you could almost do this with each sheet.
It was supposed to be partly a working camp, but you're also supposed to enjoy yourself.
There are people that really want to get things going. There's people that just say, you know, go with the flow.
Everyone's got different opinions about everything.
A lot of people are having a hard time here.
Things are getting screwed up.
I put myself under pressure that I had to work.
A work camp where people were going to do things.
Which caused a tension in myself.
My intent was that we didn't come away from this camp leaving it exactly as we found it.
People have really got all this stuff up in their minds.
But actually sowing a seed which would grow.
Yeah, and in the future we'll have a youth hostel and a dam and a learning center for the women.
We are all individual.
I don't see any kind of authority here.
And we all have our own mission here.
I don't see any kind of, well, let's really do it.
And that mission is what we feel has been given us from God.
Let's build it. Let's pool money.
Subud doesn't have any rules.
And when it comes to money and Subud and fundraising, it's just...
Everybody's Latian is individual.
So much trust has been destroyed, you know.
My personal feeling is it's between you and God. And it has been very clear here, everyone has wanted to do their own thing, and I have felt that that is, you know, really the best way to go, as long as they really do that own thing and don't sit around wondering why they're not doing that thing. And that has really been the only encouragement I've tried to give to the campus here.
I feel frustrated, that's all. I want to say that I've sound negative, but I'm not, you know. I don't know if it's just Kalimantan or if it's just the jungle or what it is, but there's something that I just feel like I'm being tested here. Like my strength, you know? My courage.
And the kind of melting pot. It became a melting pot, and that really brought it to a head, and then it just all dissolved. But actually it was being built up out of nothing. And I think that brought us all together again.
Boleh enggak pisang? Ada pisang? Minta aja pisang dulu. Harus itu dulu.
We went and talked to the Patlura, the head of the village, and he was talking about the monkey, and he said, look, if we're going to live together, you have to compromise and we have to compromise. We can't totally lead the same lifestyles. And we can't live here, or we can't really function well if you're betraying our views on, you know, our views on, you know, on wildlife and on protection and environment. And so he went and borrowed it. Me and Kayla took care of it for 2 days.
You
got more teeth than
Did Papa say that we weren't really descended from them?
No, he said they were descended from us.
Yeah, that's right.
This is what will happen to you, Sam. Hey, buddy, look over here.
So you just get happy with a banana, eating bananas, and that's what happens.
Teraz wyraz kalian yang terhormat. Kami sebagai wakil daripada persaudaraan Subud mengucapkan banyak terima kasih. Kami merasa bahwa anak-anak kami atau youth yang berada di sini adalah merupakan wakil-wakil dari kami yang datang dari berbagai negara yang mungkin banyak berbeda dengan apa yang saudara ya punyai di sini. Harap suka memaafkan apabila ada kekurangan dan kekhilafan. Dan dengan ini sekali lagi saya mengucapkan banyak terima kasih. Assalamualaikum
warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Open the pampang. And by opening this pampang, we welcome you formally, all of you, with all respect and friendship. And for the sake of friendship, permit us to smear powder. And please reciprocate as you feel like. Ya, dipukul aja ibu sedikit, ibu Rahayu dan ibu ini di bedak.
Ya, kita nanti anak kalian.
Pak Demang, Pak Demang. Pak Lurah mana? Pak Lurah bedaki juga. Dibalas aja. Ya. And all the guests will please come and
August 9th was the youth birthday, and we had almost 250, 300 people here. We had dancers of all sorts and bands. Well, I think it was a really lovely evening, and I think that Subud Youth should not forget its birthday.
I think it was important, but it was a formal thing. At the end of the night, I felt really heavy. It was really very much, but it was important for our situation here.
Thank you.
I don't know. It's like we've come to a point where it doesn't really matter now what happens in the next period of time. Before, I think, certainly as far as I was concerned, when I came here, I felt that we were coming here to achieve certain things, and we had to find out what these certain things were that we were coming to do something concrete, to do something that we all believed in, to show results, and. Gradually, I kind of realised that that's maybe not, well, that isn't what we're here for. In fact, I feel that it's more that it is to do things, but it's to do things in front of us. And actually, it doesn't matter, in fact, what we achieve, as long as we try to the best of our ability what we're going to do. And I feel that now, in a way, that's sort of relieved the pressure that we had, because in a way, it was being self-created.
Basically a rainforest which is growing back. Maybe 10 years old, everything's competing madly for light. It's pretty thick and dense, and it'll take another 100 years before it turns into a real forest. It's still beautiful. And you can see how much organic material is around this place. It's just chock-a-block thick. Really medicinal, interesting things growing in this place.
We're standing in like this huge.
We're probably standing in the cure for AIDS, yeah. Yeah, quite likely.
Well, the camp has been very helpful in one respect, and that is to gather together many people from around the world with a diversity of ideas. And actually put together one combined overall land plan, including zoning for agriculture, housing, forestry, industry, tune into what the village needs. While we've been here, we've actually constructed a pepper drying oven, which was based on a design from Ridwan Dobson.
It's a solar drying oven. It uses the sun's energy, and hopefully we can introduce it to the locals of the village.
And it's needed.
Yeah, well, I've been told it's needed so far. Yeah, I hope it's needed.
I feel that, you know, I could contribute because my subject has a very important role to play in this area in Kalimantan. Biochemistry, microbiology, it can go into various fields. But it's like the effect of Kalimantan for me personally. I don't know, it's like I've lost all my old self somewhere. And I can't, you know, bring out the active part of me for some reason. Like, even little petty things like this particular tune I play on the guitar, and I've suddenly forgotten it. It's really weird.
It was a lot of work carrying that monkey around. It's just like having a little baby, you know, 24 hours a day. You have to really have it by you, take care of it. We took it to the Department of Forestry.
I don't know. It was totally different. It's not like a cat or a dog where you're used to them around. It was, I was a little nervous. Plus he bit hard.
Was it enjoyable?
Yes.
Why?
It's like a life dream for me. I've always wanted to do things like this, help animals, and especially animals that are endangered. I wanted to be a biologist for the longest time. I kind of gave that one up, but this one's kind of made me think about it again.
Really?
Yeah.
This place begins in the village and grows out from the village. And I noticed that there's a wonder at the way the people who live here move, the gracefulness of their bodies, the coordination between the mental activity and physical activity, and their good humor. These things, it's created a kind of wonder. I think not just for me, but for many. And that's making us question our values. How can they be like that? How can we not be like that? We who have so much, apparently have so little.
Will you turn with me and reach out to the young among us and say, go there for us, for you, and for your children. Go there for the world. Find out who you are. Find out what happens next. And make it better.